for today, and I'm not able to be with you, so you get the next best thing, video in video. So today we are talking about a new type of derivative rule. It is called the chain rule. And this is most effective whenever you have composition of functions. So let's take a look at an example. So first of all, we have this example, f of x equals the quantity x squared plus 3x quantity squared. I'd like you right now to talk with your partner and to go ahead and find the derivative of this function using techniques that you know. So please pause the video. Great. So I would have expected there could be two different ways that you would have found the derivative of this function. One way is you might have chosen to expand the function. So you would have had x squared plus 3x quantity multiplied by x squared plus 3x, okay? Now, at this point, this is where you can take two different paths. One path is we could do the product rule, where we would take the derivative of the first term, second term stays the same, plus the derivative of the second term multiplied by first term stays the same. It might have been a little longer, that method. Most of you, I expect, probably expanded this by product of two binomials and got the quantity x fourth plus 3x cubed plus 3x cubed plus 9x squared. And then we combine like terms, so I end up with 6x cubed plus 9x squared. And so this is f of x. And so using the power rule, if I take the derivative, then I get 4x cubed plus 18x squared plus 18x. Fantastic. Well, this is all well and good when a binomial is being squared. But what if we have situations like this? Now, you know my smart board is not going to click very well, but let's do our best on this video. So what if you have the quantity x squared plus 3x to the third power? Well, again, we'd probably expand it, multiply it through, and take the derivative using our power rules. But what if we have the quantity x squared plus 3x to the sixth? There is no way I want to expand this six times and then distribute everything and take the derivative. There must be a better way. Or something that's not even possible to expand. What if I have f of x equals the quantity x squared plus 3x to the square root? Well, we know that to be to the 1/2 power, and this we can't even distribute that 1/2 and expand it. So there definitely has to be a different way to find the derivative of a function like this. Well, there is. I knew you knew. So I'd like to introduce this. Okay, come on, baby. With one of my favorite things, candy. And it just so happens that two of my favorite candies, Reese's Peanut Butter Cups and Twixes, both of these are what I would consider to be composite candy, like composite functions. Because don't you think of mathematics when you eat your candy? I know you do. So when I look at this candy bar, I realize that actually it's a composition of three different types of candy bar. We got the outer chocolate edge, we got the ooey gooey caramel, and then we got the yummy cracker in the inside. And when I eat my composite candy, you know, I'm going to have to bite through the chocolate layer, and that actually gets consumed, and then I get to the ooey gooey caramel, consume it, and then I get the cracker part. Now, when I am taking a bite of the outer chocolate, the inside stays the same. And then I take the derivative, or I bite the next layer, and the inside stays the same. And then finally, I can bite or take the derivative of the inside layer. Let me sample. Wow, that is really gooey caramel, but it is delicious. So, how does this relate to the chain rule, you might ask? Sorry, I hope you can't just hear my chewing really loud because I'm using my Bluetooth headphones. So how this relates to derivatives is if we have a composite function, what must happen is I'll take the derivative of the outside and the inside stays the same. And then I multiply that by the derivative of the next outside layer and the inside stays the same. And then I multiply by the derivative of the inside. And I continue until I've done all my layers. So let's say, for example, I have this example. I have the derivative of cosine of the quantity 3x to the fourth minus 2. Now I hope you realize that actually there's two layers to this function. And I have a way of demonstrating this using cups. I'll step a little closer to the camera. And as you can see here, I have two cups. The outer cup says cosine. The inner cup says 3x to the fourth minus 2. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the derivative of the outside. So the derivative of the outside is cosine, but the inside will stay the same. And then I'll multiply it by the derivative of the inside. So this is chain rule. So in this example here, what I'm going to do is take the derivative of cosine, which is sine, which is negative sine. Notice the inside stays the same. And now I multiply it by the derivative of the inside. And so the derivative, then, of this function would be negative, see the negative there, 12x cubed multiplied by sine quantity 3x to the fourth minus 2. And that's how you would do it. Now you ask, how does this relate to our original problem? Well, our original problem was quantity x squared plus 3x squared. Okay, sorry, there's my layer, squared. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the derivative of the outside, which is the squared part, inside stays the same, then multiply it by the derivative of the inside. So this problem was the quantity x to the, it was x squared plus 3x squared. So if this is my function, and I want to take the derivative of it, I take the derivative of the outside first. So the outside is the power, so I bring the power to the front, 2, inside stays the same, x squared plus 3x. And then my new degree is 1, because 2 minus 1, multiplied by the derivative of the inside, which would be 2x plus 3. So what I end up getting is 2x squared plus 6x multiplied by 2x plus 3. And then, let's see if I'm going to allow to extend this page. Woohoo! And then I get 4x to the third plus 4. Wait, that was 4x to the third. And then I'm going to have, 6x squared plus 12x squared plus 18x. So we get 4x cubed plus 18x squared plus 18x. And how does that relate to what we did at the beginning of class? Hopefully it's the same. Okay, well let's look at a couple more examples. Oh, first let's summarize what we've learned. So outside-inside rule. Oh. So sometimes with chain rule, it definitely helps me to think of it as layers. And so if you're given a composite function, so we can see it's f of g of x. So when we take the derivative of this function in respect to x, we take the derivative of the outside function first, so the derivative of f, inside stays the same, g of x, multiplied by the derivative of the inside. Derivative of the outside, inside stays the same, then multiply by the derivative of the inside function. Okay. Somehow, I already wrote on this. Oh, this is going backwards. Let's move forward. Okay, so let's look at this example. We have an object moving along an x-axis. So that means it's moving right to left. So its position is given by sine of 5t minus 3. Find the velocity. Well, we know velocity is the derivative of position. And so to find the derivative, we'll take sine of 5t minus 3 and apply the chain rule. So we can see this as a composition of two functions. The outer function is sine, so the derivative of sine is cosine. And remember, the inside stays the same. Now we multiply it by the derivative of the inside, which is 5. And so to simplify this, we bring the monomial in the front, so we have 5 cosine of 5t minus 3. That is the derivative of position, which is known as velocity. Okay, moving on along. Let's step it up a little notch. So now we have tangent of the quantity 2x minus x cubed. So again, we see it as a composition of two functions. So we'll take the derivative of the outside. Well, the derivative of tangent is secant squared x. So it's going to be secant squared of my x is the inside term, 2x minus x to the third. Now we have to multiply that by, though, the derivative of the inside. I need a little more space here. So the derivative of 2x minus x cubed will be 2 minus 3x squared. Okay, now be careful with this because it can look like I'm multiplying, it's actually secant squared of 2x, of the quantity 2x minus x cubed, and then it's multiplied by 2 minus 3x squared. So we have to be careful how we notate that. Generally, I'll bring this term 2 minus 3x squared to the front so that it's not misconstrued that I'm taking secant squared of this binomial times that binomial. So here we go. There's our correct response for that derivative. Now I'd like you to do this second video with your partner. So would you please do this, pause the video, do this with your partner on your paper, and then we'll start the video again and check in to see how you're doing. Great, so how did it go? So we take the derivative of this function. So first we take the derivative of the outer layer. Derivative of secant is secant tangent x. Ooh, now be careful. So the derivative of secant is secant x tangent x. But what is the x? Well, the x is tangent x. So the derivative of this function, I'm going to write it down here so I have enough room, and I'll switch to different colors so it's clear. So it's going to be secant of tangent x, and then tangent of tangent x. So you see, that is where I took the derivative of the outside, and the inside stayed the same. So the derivative of secant is secant of quantity, tangent of quantity. Now I'm going to multiply that by the derivative of tangent. Well, the derivative of tangent is secant squared x. Okay, so it can be a little confusing there, and I have to be very careful with my notation so that it's clear what is secant of what, tangent of what, and then again secant squared of that. So we've got basically secant squared of x times secant of tangent x times tangent of tangent x. Woo-hoo! Okay. Oh boy, we've got y equals 4 to the square root of the quantity secant x plus tangent x. Now in this function, there are actually three composites. Well, not really. What the outer one, 4, is just a coefficient. So actually, rethinking that, I'm going to think of it as two composites. So I have 4, and then the outer layer is square root, and then the inner layer is secant x plus tangent x. But in order to make this a little simpler to evaluate, I always rewrite it so that it's written as a power function. Oops, sorry, that was plus tangent x to the 1/2. So whenever you see square root, rewrite it as a power. It makes it simpler to evaluate. So now for this function, I'm going to bring the 1/2 to the front, and so I'm going to take the derivative of the outside function. So I get 2, inside stays the same, secant x tangent plus tangent x. See, I keep missing that plus and thinking my x is multiplication. Plus tangent x. Now remember to subtract 1 from the previous exponent, so I get negative 1/2. And now I'm going to multiply it by the derivative of the inside. Well, the derivative of secant is secant x tangent x plus, and the derivative of tangent is secant squared x. Ooh, we're getting a good workout on whether or not you have those derivatives of trig functions memorized. Now, to clean this up, whenever you have negative exponents, it's generally expected that you would rewrite it as a positive exponent. So in my numerator, I'm going to have 2 multiplied by secant x tangent x plus secant squared of x all over the square root of secant x plus tangent x. Okay, so this is y prime. Fantastic. Now let's see what we got rolling down here. Okay, now you're going to use a chain rule to evaluate this function. We have secant of 2 theta multiplied by tangent of 2 theta. This is more complex than we've seen. Can you see why this problem is more difficult? It's because it's a product rule. So we're going to have to apply product rule and chain rule to this problem. I'm going to need more space for this problem. So remember, product rule. When we take the product of two functions, first function stays the same, and now I have to multiply it by the derivative of the second function. Well, I have to take the derivative of tangent 2 theta, but I realize that's a composition of two functions. The outer function's tangent, the inner function's 2 theta. So I take the derivative of tangent first. Inside stays the same. So the derivative of tangent is secant squared. So it's secant squared of 2 theta. Okay. And then it's multiplied by the derivative of the inside, which is 2. Okay. So don't get lost in what you're doing. This is the first step of the product rule. First term stays the same. Derivative of the second term. Now, second term will stay the same. Tangent of 2 theta. Now I'm going to multiply that by the derivative of the first term. Well, the derivative of the first term also is a composition of two functions. It's a composition of secant theta and 2 theta. Secant, and so now the derivative of secant is secant quantity tangent quantity. Now my quantity is 2 theta. So it's going to be secant of 2 theta tangent of 2 theta. Okay. So that's the derivative of the outside. Inside stays the same. Now I'm going to multiply that by the derivative of the inside, which is 2. Woo-hoo, I'm working you today. So, wow, this whole expression is the derivative of that product. Now you're thinking, huh, can anything here be cleaned up? Yes, it can. I'm so glad you asked. So I see this monomial of 2. I'm going to bring that to the front. And then I also notice I have a secant 2 theta and a secant squared 2 theta. Well, it looks like those can be combined, right? So when you're multiplying and the base is the same, we add the exponents. So this will become secant to the third 2 theta. That works out pretty, doesn't it? Plus, now let's look at the second term here. We bring the monomial to the front, 2. Ooh, I've got a tangent 2 theta and a tangent 2 theta. So I could write this as secant 2 theta, and then it's multiplied by tangent squared 2 theta. Nice. Now my brain's working, and I'm thinking, secant theta, tangent squared theta, can that be reduced a little bit? Because I know secant is what, 1 over cosine and tangent? I don't know. I think this is probably simplified enough. So this would be the derivative of that function. Now let me check to see if I'm done or if we've got a little bit more to go here. Whoops. Nope, that is the end of this lesson for today. Tomorrow, come back, and we'll get more.